Hello everyone. Good afternoon everyone. I am Richa, Editor-in-Chief, Responsible Hospitals, and today again I am with all of you with an interesting session on painless delivery. So we will be discussing about all the facts and all the myths around the painless delivery. So this is going to be very interesting for people who are expecting or who are planning the babies. I would like them to join this session so that they can get to know about the interesting facts. Guys, there was a time when there was a myth that, all the women who want to deliver a baby, they have to go through with a lot of pain. They were not aware that there was some innovation which came up. So they used to have a lot of pain during the delivery time. They never used to enjoy their delivery. But now things have come up. There's a lot of things which have come up which can actually relieve the mother through the, it can create a good delivery experience, and it can actually give you a good way to, deliver through, epidural, and a lot of anesthesias are available. So I'll just add Dr. Priyanka, who is going to be the guest of today. So today's guest is Dr. Priyanka Anand, who is from Akash Hospital. She's a quite well-known anesthesiologist. So we would like to add her, and we would like to know a lot of myths around it, a lot of facts around it, so that a girl or a woman who is trying to opt for painless delivery, she would understand more about it, that what goes through the painless, what goes through at the delivery time, so that you can actually have a great experience of delivery, and you do not have to actually get into the pain the way it is always observed or it is always shown. So I think this is the best time that we have a lot of stuff which can relieve us through those pains, and we'll be discussing about that with the doctor. So team, can you just help me adding with her? I won't want to add Dr. Priyanka. Hi Dr. Priyanka, please send your request so that I can add you. I can see your messages over here. Yeah. So guys, in case you have any questions around that, anything which is related to painless deliveries, anything which is related to anesthesia, if you have anything in your mind, you can just drop your question in the chat box, and I'll be starting the questions soon. And I'm sure people who are joining the session, if they are mothers, they can also understand this, and they can actually help us out with the facts to their friends that, these things are very important to know, because there are a lot of myths like when you take epidural, people have the questions like that they will get back pains later on, they might get headaches. So we will be discussing on all these points, whether it is, it is good to take it or it is not good to take it. So we will be discussing that very shortly, very soon. And she would be with me soon. She's a great consultant, and she'll be guiding a number of people around the anesthesiologist. So I'll just add her soon. Team, can you just help me adding with her? Dr. Priyanka Anand, she's a consultant with Akash Hospital. She's very experienced in this, and she has been guiding a number of ladies who are going through their pregnancy journey during their labor. It is very important to understand what to take, what not to take. It is good to have a natural delivery. Everybody suggests that, go through the natural way of delivering the baby. But when there are options available, why not to take it? So during that, you would have a lot of options and questions, whether to take, how to have a good experience of delivery, how to have a painless delivery through anesthesia like epidural, and whether to use even antinox or not, whether it is helpful. So we will be discussing about all these talks just in few minutes. So she'll be with me shortly, guys. Guys, if any of your friend who is expecting a child, or if she is doubtful about anything related about painless delivery, or if she's confused whether to take epidural or not, so I would suggest on this session, or else you can just share your inputs in case they are not able to, you know, add themselves right now. Just I'm adding her. Hi, Dr. Priyanka. Can you hear me? Hello. Guys, I'm just trying to add her. Dr. Priyanka, can you hear me? Yeah. Hi,
yeah,
Dr.
Yeah.
Priyanka. Welcome to our session, first of all.
Thank you so much.
Oh, can you hear me clearly now?
Yeah, I can hear you very clearly.
Sure. So can you just take your camera a little down so that I can see you clearly? Yes.
Is it okay?
Yeah, it is better now. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
So Dr. Priyanka, I was just talking to the audience and I was just telling them, introducing you, that you have been working with the Akash Hospital and how can they have a seamless, you know, way of delivering the baby, because there was a time when a girl, and there was a myth that, you know, they, if they have to deliver a baby, they had to go through a lot of pain. So it was a myth around it. But nowadays, when there's a so much into it, we have so many things which can help a woman to have a great delivery experience. I would like our audience to know more about it, because there are a lot of myths about it. There are a lot of pros and cons. So I would want them to understand it. So I would like to welcome you, first of all. It's great having you here. And
thank you so much.
Thank you. So let's start with it. Doctor, please tell us, what do you mean by painless delivery, first of all?
To begin with, first, let me talk about labor pain. See, the labor pain starts when the 9 months of pregnancy are completed. The uterus starts contracting. The cervix has to open for the baby to deliver. And it is a very painful experience. And painless labor is when we relieve the mother of all the pain which she is bearing for delivering her baby. And these days we have a lot of modalities. There are some which are non-pharmacological. There are some which are pharmacological. Though we don't have much data on the non-pharmacological things, like the TENS, which is spontaneous electrical nerve stimulation, with hydrotherapy, massage, these are all theoretical things. The main thing which we have for painless delivery.
Sorry to cut you, doctor. I think there's some noise happening at your end. I don't know if it is with the earphones. There's a noise and movement running behind. Can you try picking up your earphones and try?
Yeah, I'll try without the earphones.
I think this is better. No, again, it is hard.
Okay. Is it better without the earphones?
No, I think the noise is quite high. Can you just try talking? I'll just see.
Has the noise gone?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So we were talking about this painless delivery. One is the non-pharmacological things which we have, like hydrotherapy. There is one, transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. Then there is hypnosis and acupuncture. See, we don't have much data for all this. These are all theoretical things, fine. But the actual thing is the pharmacological thing, in which we provide epidural anesthesia or a combined spinal epidural to the patient to relieve her from her pain. Because, see, pain is an emotional stress. It is a physical stress. It causes trauma to the tissues. And there are various side effects of having all these pains. So labor epidural is the trend these days. Any pregnant female, she should be aware that she can always go in for a painless delivery, which will, you know, make her very comfortable. And it will not be a fear anymore. As, see, whenever a patient is in labor, she has pain, which is the unit of pain is in death, okay? And a human being can experience pain, can bear pain, which is around, you know, say 36 to 40 dels. And when we deliver, the pain is to the intensity of 57 del, which is very, very high. It is equivalent to breaking of 20 bones together. So you can imagine the intensity of the pain. And labor epidural, every pregnant female, she should interact with her obstetrician and also the anesthesiologist who is going to finally provide the patient with the labor epidural.
Sure. So how does this process take place? I mean, how do they go about it?
Okay. It is a very simple procedure. When the patient starts her labor pains, that is the labor pains means the uterus has started contracting. Whenever the uterus starts contracting, the patient will request. We cannot force a patient to take a labor epidural. We can just suggest her for it. It's her call or the family's call. And once they decide that they have to take a labor epidural, the anesthetist will come and explain the procedure to her. It is a very simple procedure. The patient will be sitting and the doctor, the anesthetist, would be standing on her back. They will palpate the spine. See, we can feel the spine of the patient. We'll feel the spine and we'll give a very small injection, which will be like a sting of a bee. That only that much pain will be felt, and we'll anesthetize that area. Okay, that is in the lumbar area actually. The lumbar is area, I would explain it to the layman as a place where the pelvis is, just above the pelvis, the spine just above the pelvis. So we'll just palpate it and we'll give an injection to anesthetize that area, and then we'll draw in a catheter there. Through this catheter, the drug will be deposited and she will pain, numbness, she'll feel numbness from the belly button to the upper part of the legs. So okay. She will be able to feel the contractions, but she will not feel the pain. So when the final stage of delivery comes, where the patient has to push hard, she'll be able to push, but without any pain. That means.
Okay. So, Doctor, do tell us, is it available in, every hospital? Or do they have to register it before that they want to go ahead with the epidural? How does it work?
Wherever an anesthetist is available, whenever there is a nursing home or a big hospital setup, I would always recommend all the pregnant females to go to a big setup, because, we think that just a cesarean section. It's not like that, There are major complications which can occur during delivery. And, the child might need ICU when the child is born. God forbid that should not happen, but it can happen also. So, small nursing homes, they do not have facilities for the ICU. Though labor epidural can be provided in any small setup also. Big hospital, right. Small hospital, nursing home, it is available everywhere.
Okay. Sure. And is it a part of the package or do they have to ask for it?
No, it is actually not a part of the package. They have to ask for it, and there are actually separate charges for it.
Sure, because why I'm asking is a lot of people just consult and they check that they want to deliver, and they are not even aware when they, register themselves later, they get to know, okay, I have to have a separate charge. So,
yeah, they have no.
I think again there's bad noise, which is interesting.
I'll
wait for you online.
I think the noise
it is better now.
Yeah,
it is not now. I mean, it is fine now. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Yes, it's better now. It's better now. We can continue talking. Yeah. So, Doctor, do tell us, because there are a lot of myths around it, that while taking the epidural, people get headaches, they get back pains later on, and then if not that day, probably a little later. What do you think about it?
See, as far as this backache concept is concerned, there is no backache that happens with either the spinal or the epidural. See, whenever a patient is pregnant, whenever a lady is pregnant, she has, there is laxity of all the joints and the ligaments of the pelvis area. Fine. So, this laxity actually leads to the backache. It's not the spinal or the epidural. Fine. And she has to exercise after her delivery so that her back muscles strengthen up. Well, ultimately, what happens is a female who has undergone a cesarean section or has taken an epidural, they put the blame on that tiny little needle, which is, equivalent to the diameter of our hair. Can you imagine such a small needle causing a back pain? No, it doesn't happen. It is just a myth which needs to be clarified. Of course, there are a few side effects whenever we give epidural. The blood pressure falls down a little bit. But that the patient doesn't have to worry about, because the anesthetist is there, the sisters are there, the gynecologist is there to monitor all that. And we have all the monitors attached to the patient. We are giving her fluid simultaneously. So, if you convey the risk-benefit ratio, the benefits are far ahead as compared to the risk involved.
Okay. And do they have to plan? I mean, do they have to pre-plan if they want to go ahead with the epidural? Do they discuss this with the gynees and they can just plan it on the spot?
Yeah, actually, if they haven't planned it, they can do it on the spot also. But now that, women are educated, they know what they are going through, so they can always plan it beforehand. But there is nothing to worry if a person hasn't planned it, they can do it on the spot also.
Okay. Doctor, do share your thoughts with even after taking the epidural, how much pain relief they get and for how much time it stays?
If we start the epidural at the beginning of the labor pain, say the patient has just started off with her contractions and she has made up her mind, the ladies are so educated these days, they have made up their mind that I want to go in for a painless labor. We can put the epidural there and then, okay? And then she will not feel the pain. See, the pain, if the pain is 100 to the intensity of 100, it will be relieved by 95%. That 5% thing will remain because she will feel the contractions. She will feel that the contractions are happening, but the pain associated. See, I have actually seen people, I have given epidural to so many females. When I reach the labor room, the lady is shouting, and you can hear the voice still 400 meters away. It's that bad. And once the epidural is within 15 to 20 minutes, she's like calm and I have seen people just dozing off also after that because they're so tired of screaming and that pain, it is like really bad. And the labor epidural pain will free them of that pain at least 25%. And they just sleep off. So I think women should go for the epidural and not to worry about the side effects as such.
Sure. And I've also heard that, when they take epidural and, unconsciously, it's very difficult to push the baby at that time and to do a natural birth.
See, if I'm without an epidural, I'm delivering a baby, I can push with my strength of 100%, okay, with that immense amount of pain. And when I'm with epidural, I'm 95% pain-free. And I can push with the intensity of not 100, but maybe 80. So whenever we have an epidural, see, there are in out of 100 cases, 80 would deliver without any help. And the rest 20 may need a forceps delivery, an instrumental delivery.
Okay. Okay. So is it a decision of a doctor or they guide that they should right now opt for epidural? Is it the right time? Or they show that, this is the right time and I should go about it now because they are already in the pain and they actually need guidance. Sometimes they are not aware that, they do not have to take more pain and they can just directly go with the epidural or such. So what do you think? I mean, how this goes about? I mean, do you suggest or they ask you for it? Or if the husband comes in the picture?
The anesthetist is not per se in direct contact with the patient who is delivering. That patient is in contact with her obstetrician. So she can always request the obstetrician, if she has the knowledge, that, ma'am, I can't bear this pain and I would like to go in for a painless delivery. And then the obstetrician would call us. And the doctor can, obviously, the obstetrician can always suggest, they should actually talk to the patient, suggesting them that this is also an option. If they are not doing it, my friends who are online, they can always request their obstetrician that they would like to go in for a painless delivery. So it can be either ways. The doctor can also suggest, the patient can also request.
Okay, and is there any condition which is specific wherein you do not suggest epidural at all?
Yeah, there are a few contraindications. See, if the patient has low platelet count, whenever the patient would come, we will always do their blood investigations. A CBC, a complete blood count, is done, wherein we can see that the patient has what is the platelet count. If the patient has a platelet count which is less than 75,000, we would not recommend a epidural. If the patient has some spine deformity, we would not recommend. If the patient has undergone some spine surgery, if the patient has some kind of infection at the local site, we will not suggest it. Yeah, or
Sure.
there is some bleeding disorder, coagulation profile disorder. Maybe there are some patients who have a tendency to bleed, and if they bleed, the bleeding doesn't stop. That is because there is some deficiency of the clotting factors. So the patient is aware of all that, and if she has all those conditions, we will not recommend a epidural.
Sure.
Otherwise,
Okay.
besides, there are no contraindications.
Okay. Sure. So, doctor, do tell me because I'm also a mother of one. So, I also opted for epidural. I took epidural before. But I tried initially for water birthing. And then the doctor suggested me, you know, that if you take a water birth, if you opt for that, you might not be able to take the epidural. I just came out. I said, okay, then I will not go for water birth. So, why there is something like that? Why they can't take it in the water birth? And do share some inputs on that as well.
Sir, see, a water bath is just a it's a kind of hydrotherapy. Okay, so when you are in the water bath, we cannot put the epidural because the conditions for putting the epidural are not conducive. We need a sterile, aseptic environment for putting the epidural because we are entering very near to the spinal cord. So it is, if you are sitting in water, the water can have some kind of infection. We cannot put in the epidural, and if we try to do it, the water can get into the spinal cord, into the near the spinal cord, which can be, infectious, and then the infections would be to the tune of meningitis, etc. So you cannot do it in that atmosphere.
Sure. And imagine if a girl is taking a lot of pain. Now she has taken the epidural also, but still she was not able to, you know, deliver naturally, and she had to go for C-section. So the another anesthesia which is given to her, or you do the refilling, how does it work?
See, when we give an epidural, we give the same medications which we give for a cesarean section, but with lesser intensity and less fine. When we give an epidural, we just take care of the sensory part. Sensory means that the patient will not have pain, but she can move around. And she can, do her, she can go to the toilet and she can do all those things. But when she's not able to progress, and we have decided now that the fetus is getting affected and we'll have to take her for a cesarean section, then through the same epidural, we put the drug in a larger amount and a bigger concentration so that from that sensory part, it gets converted into a total anesthesia. We are giving an analgesia in epidural. From the analgesia, we convert it to anesthesia. So there's nothing separate anesthesia that will be given. We will make use of the same epidural catheter which we have inserted in our epidural space.
Can you just define more what is the difference between analgesia and anesthesia for the
The analgesia is when we are getting rid of the pain. The pain which is caused because of contraction, because of the cervical dilatation, which is caused because of the tissue damage that is happening, that is analgesia. Anesthesia is when we are aborting all the types of touch receptors, the pain, the sensory part, the motor part, the muscles, everything. Then it will give a feeling of numbness. You will feel that your legs have disappeared. There are no legs at all. And if we ask you to move your legs, you will not be able to move them at all. That will be anesthesia. This I'm talking about regional anesthesia because epidural and spinal are regional anesthesias. We are not making the patient bonk off. We are just body. The lower part of the body would appear, it does not exist. That is anesthesia. Analgesia is when we know that the pain has gone, we can move our body, we can do everything. Like we take Trocin. I am having a headache.
You are in conscious state.
Yes, the patient would be conscious. But in regional anesthesia, the patient is conscious but cannot move anything. Yeah.
Understood. Cool, good enough. And any complications which occur, you know, because of, you said, you know, analgesia, natural anesthesia, you think any complications occur?
There are minimal complications, like till the patient has delivered, till the epidural is going on, she can have muscle weakness. The patient can have nausea. Nausea would basically occur because when we put epidural, the blood pressure would slightly fall. Mm-hmm. That can cause nausea. The patient can have some shivering. The worst thing is that the patient can have a post-dural functional headache. That is a headache which will last for a week or so. But that depends on the competence and the proficiency and the efficiency of the anesthetist.
Okay. So I think I've got all my facts. Anything which you want to tell your audience, that whether they should, you know, definitely go and try epidural rather than just getting scared, no, it will affect me later on, it will affect my lower back. So any guidelines which you would want to give it to them?
I would like to tell them about the benefits of labor analgesia. Whenever we have pain, a lot of pain, you know, what happens is the placental blood flow. Placenta is the communication between the mother and the baby. Fine. And through the placenta, all the nutrition, all the blood that is going to the fetus is going through the placenta. So whenever, suppose I am a patient and having pain, what will happen is the placental blood flow would be compromised. So what happens is the blood flow to the fetus will decrease. The patient, the child will have hypoxia. Hypoxia means decrease in the oxygen content of the child's blood. And the patient can have acidosis. Okay? The child can have acidosis. One thing is this. Then, whenever we are having pain, there is increase in certain kind of hormones which are present in the body, which are known as catecholamines. Catecholamines will cause an increase in the blood pressure, and that would again affect the fetal circulation. See, these all things are happening at such a micro level that we don't realize. Ultimately, when the baby is born, it is flabby, it is tired, it is hypoxic, it is acidotic. The baby has to fight all that, you know. So if we take care of this part, we will not make the baby suffer. Then there are the pain we cause also release of a hormone which is called as adrenocorticotropic hormone, which will affect the electrolyte metabolism, the protein metabolism, and the carbohydrate metabolism. And a female who has been in so much of pain for such a long time, you know, for a primary patient, the pain can last for around 12 hours. So it can also lead to post-traumatic stress syndrome. So all these things are prevented if we take your labor epidural.
Sure. So, Dr. Priyanka, you are suggesting that rather than taking that much pain and rather than waiting for so many hours and get into the stress stage, we should actually offer epidural because it is going to benefit and there is no much harm which you are suggesting, right? So, guys, I think this is all we would like to suggest. In case anybody has specific questions or doubts, you can directly connect with Dr. Priyanka Anand. She is available at Akash Hospital. You can directly connect with her on Instagram as well. And I think that's all about it. Thank you so much, Dr. Priyanka. Thanks for giving me your inputs. I think it's really good, insightful session which you gave. And people must be more clear about, you know, that whether they should take or not. And there's no actually harm. Even I have taken it myself. And frankly, I'm good with my back and I'm totally fine with it.
Yeah.
And my baby is just, he's 2 years old. I never faced any challenge, thankfully, that way. So thanks to my anesthesiologist. So thanks to you for having this session. Thank you.
Thank you so much. If there are any questions anyone wants to ask, I'm here to answer.
I think we have already done with, we have already clarified so much today. I don't see any questions for the first time. So it's good. In case they would have, definitely we'll connect with you.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was great having you here. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.